Hi, I'm Bill Kleitz. The material that I'll be covering in this podcast is out of my Digital Electronics 9th Edition textbook. I hope you find it useful.
So, the 555 is a real popular general purpose timer IC. Manufacturers realize so many people need it to have timing oscillators and one shots that they custom built an integrated circuit timer just for that application. So figure 14-20 shows the internal connections inside of 555 and some external R's and C's that we could put on here to form an astable operation. This is going to charge discharge repeatedly so that the output is just going to be a nice square wave, and we'll be able to predict exactly what the T high, T low is going to be. So basically inside the 555, everything inside this orange box got its name from 5K, 5K, 5K in series, and these are set up as a voltage divider. For example, let's say the VCC was set up at 6 volts. If we had 6 volts there, this 5K would drop 2, this would drop 2, and this would drop 2. So with that in mind, what do you think the voltage would be right where my pen is on the top of the first comparator? That would be 2 volts. And then there's 2 additional volts across here, that would be 4 volts. So the top comparator's minus terminal sitting at 4, this one is sitting at 2. And that's going to be critical in our analysis of the timing. So the way a comparator works is if the positive is greater than the negative, the output becomes a 1. So in other words, if this voltage right where my pen is higher than 4, this turns into a 1, which does an R, which is a reset of the flip-flop. This comparator has got 2 on it, like we said, right? So if the minus is less than 2, this would be a 0. I'm sorry, if it's less than 2, then this must be greater than 2. This is 2, so this is greater. So in other words, if the plus is greater than the minus, the output is a 1. So if this is 2 and this is, let's say, 1.9, this would be a 1 coming out of here, which would do a set. Now a set, setting a flip-flop, sets Q. We're just looking at the not Q on this. So when you do a set, essentially you're getting a 0 here. Now 0 here gets inverted into a 1, we'd have a high output. A reset here would make Q a low, which actually makes this a high. When this is high, the output would end up being low, right? So also, when this high goes down to an NPN discharge transistor. If you put a high on the base relative to the emitter of an NPN, this becomes a short from C to E. So when this is a short, look where that's connected. Right to the RB and the C discharge path. So that's how we're going to discharge this capacitor down through and down through when this is a high here. So let's go through the analysis. When we first power up, let's use 6 volts again for VCC. So if VCC is 6 volts, again, this will be a 2 volt drop, 2 volt drop, 2 volt drop. So this voltage right here is sitting at 4. And we're checking the voltage on the capacitor right there, and this voltage right here is sitting at 2. Let's not forget that. Okay, so when we first power up, the capacitor has been discharged overnight, let's say. We have a charging current coming down through. As the capacitor voltage starts charging up, as soon as it reaches 4 volts and exceeds it by, let's say, 4.1, if you have 4.1 volts right here, that voltage is going to go up here, 4.1 right there, this is 4, it just made the plus more plus. When that happens, this becomes a 1. The 1 does a reset. A reset makes Q low, but makes not Q high. With a high here, this becomes a low output, but the high puts a high on the base of an NPN, which shorts the collector to emitter. With this shorted, we have a path for the discharge current. So this capacitor was charged up to 4.1, now has a direct short to ground this way, and it's going to start discharging. So the capacitor discharges through RB. Now it goes from 4.1 down to 4, down to 3.9. Let's see what happens at 3.9. When this is 3.9 up here, the plus is not more plus. This goes to a zero. Also with 3.9, this label called trigger, 3.9 right here, the plus right here is 2. This is not greater, so this is also a zero. So we have a 0, 0 on a flip-flop. Remember what that does? It just does a hold. So whatever condition this was in, it stays the same, which was a high on the base keeps us shorted. This will continue to discharge. When do you think it'll stop discharging? You got it, when the capacitor drops below 2. So let's say the capacitor discharges down to 1.9. If you put 1.9 on this voltage, the 1.9 right there, remember this was a 2, 1.9 here, guess what? The plus is greater than the minus now. So that puts a 1 here, which does a set. A set on a flip-flop makes Q, which is not here. It makes Q a high, which makes this a low. A low here gives you a high output, but the low also changes the state of the discharge transistor. This becomes an open, and it stops allowing the discharge current to go any further. So the capacitor drops just below 2 volts, let's say 1.99. And then with this open now, the capacitor will now receive a current from the VCC, and it'll start charging up again. Note that the charging path is through RA and RB times the C. So the charging path, and again, it cycle repeats. It starts charging up as soon as it hits 4.1. 4.1 on the cap puts 4.1 up here on the plus of this top comparator. 4.1 is greater than 4. So this becomes a high, does a reset. The reset makes this line high, turns on the transistor, and the cycle just repeats again. How cool is that? So now when you look at equation 14.2 and 14.5, you have the same general equation for the time it takes a capacitor to charge up, knowing the two voltages. The delta V voltage actually goes from the 1/3 VCC point up to the 2/3 VCC. So if you take 2/3 VCC minus 1/3 VCC, that gives you 1/3 VCC. And the starting point, which we said was 2 volts, is going up to 4, but it's trying to go to 6. That's actually 2/3 VCC. And when you look at this fraction, 1/3 over 2/3, that's a half. And you plug this into this equation, you'll end up with the natural log of 2. So the final equation for T low is 0.693 RB times C. Now the T low is occurring during the discharge time. That's why we're only using the RB value. Then to drive the equation for T high, the delta V is also 1/3 VCC because it's going from the 2/3 VCC down to the 1/3 VCC while the output is high. E, the total distance, is going to be from the 2/3 VCC down toward, or actually it's from the VCC down to the 1/3 VCC. That's the total distance it's trying to travel. So in other words, as a capacitor starts at 1/3 VCC and goes up toward VCC, you just subtract these two numbers. And then the time constant, or the path the charging current flows through, is both resistors. So the final equation is RA plus RB times C times the natural log. And again, it's going to be the 1/3, which is the delta V, and the 2/3, which is the E value. That again turns into be 0.5. And when you take the natural log of 2 is actually that 0.693. So here's the equation for T high. So we have the equation for T high, and we got the equation for T low. What else would you need? Well, you might want to know how to calculate duty cycle, frequency, and so on. But let's look at an actual example. Here's example 14.10, which is going to show the circuit in figure 22. I've got an RARB connected with a capacitor, and we'll be looking at the output waveform and the voltage on the capacitor. So the RB value, which is 10K, is used in this equation. We'll get 4.71 micro for the low period, and we'll have the RA plus RB for the high, because remember it's charging through both those resistors, and that'll be 693 micro for the high. The duty cycle can be found just by T high over the sum of the two, and the frequency is the reciprocal of the two times. So we got a frequency of 85.9 kHz. So I kind of skipped over this figure, but figure 21, which shows us the initially the capacitor will start at zero. We'll kind of ignore this very first period, but once it gets above that two-thirds mark, then the output switches to the low, just like I discussed. So the output is low, and then it starts discharging down to the one-third, and then it goes up to the two-thirds, and then down to the one-third. And the example I just talked about, this would be 4 volts, 2 volts, 4 volts, 2 volts, and so on. Now the discharge path is through just RB times C. I call that the tau discharge path. The tau charging path is RA plus RB times the C. The other thing we didn't talk about is when this output is high, Vout high typically on the standard 555 is whatever your supply voltage is minus 1.5. So it's a 1.5 volt loss internal to the typical 555. And the output low is typically around 0.1. So that's a pretty good high-low level value. So one way to check our calculation is to run a multisim of it. So we'll use the same values that were presented in example 10. And so our R will be 4.7 and our RB will be 10K. And the capacitor will be the same as what we used in that example. So let's go and grab this multisim program and see if these waveforms match up with what we calculated. So this would be figure 1423 example. So if I open that up, let's take a look at, and I'll hide the description box for just a minute. So here it is. We've got the RB is a 10K, RA is a 4.7, and then we got capacitor of 680 picofarads. Now this 10 nanofarad is just a compensating capacitor just to maintain a steady value for the VCC if, in case there's any small spikes or noise on the VCC line. So that doesn't come into any effect in the calculation. So if we double click on the oscilloscope, and I'll drag this up here so we can see it, and run the simulation, we'll get the waveforms for the capacitor and for the Vout, and I'll stop it momentarily. Now notice I've got a minus 2 on the Y position of channel B. That's why the B waveform starts down 2 divisions. Otherwise it would have been up here in the way of the capacitor waveform. Capacitor is set up at zero. So the capacitor starts at zero and we're at 2 volts per division. Zero, it's going to go up to 4. It goes up to 4, down to 2, up to 4, down, just like what we thought it was going to do. And the output is on 5 volts per division. It goes from zero up to, that's probably around 6, so the multi-sim simulation is not taking away the 1.5, which is fine. That's a model change you could make in multi-sim, or just realize that this 6 volt output level may be a little bit less when you actually build it in lab. But now let's drag these cursors and look at the period. So if I look at the high output period, drag that one to there, and that one to there, and we've got 7 microseconds, and the calculation said that we were going to have 6.93 microseconds, pretty close, and the T low should be 4.71. So let's give that and take a look, see if we can see that. So the T low, I'll drag it to there and to there, sure enough 4.7 or 4.8, something like that. Now let's see what other exercises I'm going to ask you to do. So if you go to view description box, besides running the program as is, we're going to recalculate in step B. We'll be asked to recalculate the values for RA and RB to create a 50 kHz 60% duty cycle square wave. So go through those calculations using a capacitor 0.0022 And a good hint would be to look at problem 14-19 at the end of the book. It gives you a clue on how to solve that. So make sure you try that and run it and see if the oscilloscope gives you the results you expect. So one problem that my students face is I always ask for a 50% duty cycle last table. And you might realize you can't get a 50% with the circuit we have because RA plus RB is used for the charging path, and then just RB is used for the discharge path. So no matter, you'd have to make RA equal to a, or I'm sorry, make RA equal to a zero, which you can't do, because you would put VCC directly on pin 7. So because of the charging path through the RA plus RB and the discharging through just the RB, therefore you can't get a 50% duty cycle. But I'll show you a trick in the next figure. And so what we do here is we put a diode across the RB, so the charging path is down through RA through the diode into the cap. The discharge path is going to go up through the RB value only. So the charge path is RA only, the discharge path is RB only, and if you make RB equal to RA, you'll get your 50% duty cycle. The new equation would just be the 0.693 RA for the high and the 0.693 RBC for the low, which gives you a 50% duty cycle. The nice thing also about this is you can actually get less than 50% by making RA less than RB. So we got all sorts of flexibility with this circuit. Okay, so next we'll look in section 8 about how we can use the 555 in the monostable one-shot mode.